Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our text this morning is the text from the Holy Gospel, the 14th chapter of John, verses 15 to 21. And our theme this morning, Jesus' farewell gift, the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. My dearest brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, when a member of your family has to say goodbye, emotions run high, tears flow, hearts ache. We truly don't want to be separated from our loved ones, from our family. And yet, graduations, jobs, or even retirements may make it necessary to move across the state or across the country, or even to another country. And it's in times like these that a farewell gift may be given as a keepsake, as a reminder of your deep, deep love for them. And such a gift is always dearly treasured. This morning, from the Gospel of St. John, Jesus is saying goodbye. And it wasn't any easier for him than it is for us. Yet, Jesus isn't thinking of himself, even though he knew what was about to happen to him. Betrayal, denial, a brutal whipping, slander, the nailing to a cross, death, and burial. In his perfect divine love, he is caring for his disciples. He knew that they needed to be reassured. After all, he had been now with them for almost three and a half years, but now they would no longer see him. So Jesus makes a promise. He makes a promise of the giving of a farewell gift. But it's the perfect farewell gift. Not a picture or a plaque. No, his gift is the perfect gift. It's the gift of the Holy Spirit. Dearly beloved, Jesus wasn't just thinking of his disciples then. He was also thinking of you today. Even though God's plan of salvation was accomplished some 1,980 or so years ago, you, like his disciples there in the upper room, need assurances. You also need to be comforted. God's word today truly, truly reassures you that you too share in his farewell gift. And that his farewell gift given to you there at the font is a treasured gift given to each of you. And a gift that we as his children must always treasure in our hearts and in our lives. Last week you heard Jesus tell Thomas and the 10, and by the way, each and every one of you, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes to the Father except through him. With these words, Jesus clearly reveals to you and to me that there's one way to heaven. But now Jesus is leaving. What are they going to do? How could they keep going without Jesus at their side? Without Jesus leading them, comforting them, helping them, and protecting them. Therefore, Jesus gives to them, and he gives to you the perfect farewell gift. A gift that will meet each and every one of their needs, and a gift that meets all of your needs. The promise of Jesus we have heard today. Jesus said, "And I will ask the Father, and another helper he will give to you, that he might be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. In other words, Jesus promised the disciples the third person of the Holy Trinity, the Holy Spirit, the Counselor, the Comforter. The word counselor means one who gives aid or help. Now, the disciples had already experienced the work of the Counselor in their lives already, even though they may not have realized it, for it was the Counselor who brought them to faith in Jesus. The Bible tells us very clearly that no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Thus, as you may remember, Buddy and Bo stood here, and they confessed that Jesus is their Lord. And that was the work of the Holy Spirit, which they received there at the font. You see, the Holy Spirit's always at work, just as you heard with our children. He's always at work, pointing us to the Word of truth, pointing us to the cross, where you and I have been saved, pointing us to the altar, where we receive His body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. In other words, the Holy Spirit will always, always, always direct our attention to Jesus. If someone says that the Holy Spirit is directing you to someone else or something else, that's not the Holy Spirit. That's a different kind of spirit, and that spirit must be resisted. Now, since the Holy Spirit is God, with the same attributes as God the Father and God the Son, He is beyond our human reason. So the world cannot accept Him. And I think that's obvious to all of us. All you have to do is watch the news, read your newspaper, and some of the silly things that are said about the Holy Spirit, or some of the awful things that are said about Jesus, tells us that the world cannot accept the Holy Spirit and that they cannot accept Jesus. But Jesus tells us that His true disciples, they will recognize the Holy Spirit because they believe Jesus and they believe His life-saving word. Therefore, the Holy Spirit now lives in their hearts, and He lives in the hearts of all Christian people, a gift given to each of you. Yes, a gift given to you, as you have already heard at the font. What a God. What a Savior. What a Spirit of truth. He is always with us, and He will never, ever leave us. When things look hopeless, Jesus has everything under control. His gift is the perfect gift, given at the perfect time, so that His disciples then and today, once again, so that all their needs and all your needs may be met, so that they may be happily met. Yes, we know that in this day and age, we like to think that we are living in the greatest time of human history. And since we are living in the greatest time of human history, that we are the enlightened ones, that we can figure all of this out. And actually, the world wants to convince you that you don't need things that you can't see. If you can't see it, then it's not real. Therefore, you can figure it out yourself, or even worse, you can do it yourself. You can find your own way to heaven. You can work your way into heaven. You can speak your way into heaven. But you know, even though we now live in the 21st century, things haven't changed one iota from the first century. Dear ones, let's be honest with each other. We all have a basic fear, don't we? Same then, same today. We have a fear of being alone. We have a fear of being forgotten. We have a fear of not being loved. What if there's no one to come to your side? What if there's no one to help you? What if there's no one to comfort you? What if there's no one to love you? Physical and spiritual doubts will quickly overwhelm us. So often we think we can go it alone. We are tempted to think that I really don't need God. Remember the temptation in the garden? It's still the same today. And it's still the same temptation that Jesus heard. If there is a God. Or even worse, when tragedy comes into our lives, and none of us are exempt, when the suffering comes into our lives, we are tempted to kind of step out of it, kind of step to the side and become the referee. And then we get to decide who's at fault. And more often than not, dear ones, because of our sinful human nature, when the suffering comes into our life, when these tragedies come into our lives, we want to blame God. Simply put, the Son of God, Jesus, who is the Christ, it is He who has saved you from all these temptations. It is He who has saved you from suffering, even though you will suffer in this life. There's no doubt about that. It is He and only He who is willing to sacrifice Himself, to sacrifice His perfect life upon the cross in your place. It is Jesus who has freed you and me from our eternal enemies, from sin, from death and the power of the devil. Yes, it is true. Your Redeemer lives. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Therefore, who shall separate you from the love of God? The very question that Paul asked of the Romans. The very question that is asked of you today. Who shall separate us from the love of God? The answer? Nothing. No one. You and I live knowing that we have a Savior who loves us. But how do we really know for sure? How do we really, really know that Jesus loves you? How do you know that He's there for you? How do you know? Because Jesus gave to you the farewell gift. His perfect farewell gift. Because there at the font, He has given you the Holy Spirit. He has given you a good conscience. And it is the Holy Spirit who works this in you. It is the Holy Spirit who directs you to the Word, who directs you to body and blood, who directs you here today so that you will hear of what Jesus has done for you. The Holy Spirit meets all your needs today, tomorrow, and forevermore. As the Holy Spirit will comfort you with the knowledge and the truth that your faith in Jesus is not a lie. He reassures you that you have been saved, that your sins are forgiven, that God is with you, and He will never, ever forsake you. The Holy Spirit continues to speak to you today and to comfort you and to reassure each and every one of you through the words of the liturgy, through this sermon, through hymns and prayers. Wherever God's word is proclaimed, dear ones, there His word is converting hearts and strengthening faith. And that's what the Holy Spirit's doing this very moment. The Holy Spirit has empowered you. He has empowered you to love Jesus by showing your love to your neighbor. Therefore, in closing, be at peace. Know that Jesus will keep His promise. Remember His promise? I will not leave you as orphans. I am coming to you. He's coming to you now. He comes to you when His body and blood, here He is truly present to serve you. And He is coming that great last day. He is coming to you, and He is coming for you. And so He does. And so He does, as He proclaims to each and every one of you this very moment, that all your sins are forgiven, each and every sin forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.